بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد سيد الأولين والآخرين وعلى جميع إخوانه من النبيين والمرسلين وآل كل وصحب كل ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما يا رب العالمين All praise is due to Allah and may Allah raise the rank of Prophet Muhammad peace be upon him and protect his nation from that which he fears for them. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, let us first have the proper intention in our hearts to attend the lesson for the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In our lesson, we'll continue explaining the creed of Imam Abu Ja'far At-Tahawi. We did mention before that Imam Abu Ja'far At-Tahawi is one of the prominent Salaf, meaning he lived in the first 300 years after the immigration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from Mecca to Medina. Those scholars who lived in the first 300 years after the immigration of the Prophet are called as Salaf, the predecessors. He was a very prominent scholar at the time. He was following the school of Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu in the Islamic jurisprudence. He wrote this book which held a high regard amongst the scholars of Islam since he authored it. It's a very small book, and he mentioned at the beginning that this is the creed of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, meaning the Muslims of this nation. That's what they believe. So that's their belief. All those who follow the methodology of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they form the majority of this nation, are on this belief. The belief of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. When he says that this is the belief of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, to show that whoever wants to be following the Prophet and the companions should adopt this belief in his heart. He should have this belief in his heart. He mentioned about Allah, about the Prophet, about the angels, about the destiny, about the day of judgment, and other related matters that are part of the creed of the Muslims. So what he means by this, that every Muslim should have this belief in his heart. So one has to give great attention to this aqeedah, this creed of Imam Abu Ja'far At-Tahawi, to make sure, yes, this is what I believe. Because this is the belief that will save you in the hereafter. Because it's not simply uttering the two testifications of faith by your tongue and that's it, that means you'll be admitted into paradise, while you have in your heart a belief that is contradicting to the meanings of the two testifications of faith. So if one utters the two testifications of faith by his tongue, while in his heart he believes something contradicting to the meanings of the two testifications of faith, he wouldn't be classified as Muslim. That's why one has to believe in the two testifications of faith, the proper belief, in order to be classified as Muslim. We talked about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam being the last of all the prophets and messengers, and that he is the seal of all the prophets, meaning there is no prophet after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No one would receive prophethood after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Although the Prophet did mention in the hadith that the day of judgment will not occur until 30 imposters claim prophethood, the last of whom is Al-A'war Ad-Dajjal, the one-eyed, known as the one-eyed imposter. That one is the last of them. So 30 people after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam will claim prophethood. Two at the time of the Prophet claimed prophethood, Al-Aswad Al-Ansi and Musaylima Al-Kazzab, two. Later on, other people claimed prophethood, and this situation will continue until the Day of Judgment. Now, by the time the Day of Judgment occurs, the number of those who have claimed prophethood after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam will be 30, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned. So one has to believe. So when one says, I testify that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, this includes believing that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last prophet and messenger. Not only to believe that he is the messenger of God, one has to believe as well that Prophet Muhammad is the last of all the prophets and messengers. This is included in the meaning of the testification of faith. Now Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi discusses a very, very important topic in what he mentioned after this. It's regarding the Quran and the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a very, very important topic that needs to be understood properly and comprehended fully, so no one would be confused about this matter. Let me explain something first. It's amongst the fundamentals of our belief that Allah does not resemble the creations. And this is taken from the ayah in Surah Ash-Shura, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ, it means nothing resembles Allah in any way whatsoever. وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ, Allah is attributed with hearing and sight. So when a Muslim recites this ayah, from the first section of the ayah, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ, he understands that nothing resembles Allah in any way whatsoever. When he continues reading the ayah, وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ, so Allah is attributed with hearing and sight, the Muslim, the believer, will quickly react to this ayah by saying, the hearing of Allah is not like our hearing. The seeing of Allah is not like our seeing. So that is known from the ayah itself. This ayah is enough, is sufficient to clear Allah from any resemblance to the creations. It's a clear for the one whose heart is open. But those whose hearts are blocked and locked and dimmed and blackened, so even they recite it but they don't understand it. But it's very simple. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. Because Allah is the creator, and the creator logically does not resemble the creations. So if you ask even children, who made this chair? They won't say, the other chair made it. Because logically, they don't accept that a chair would create a chair. A table would create a table. This is logically impossible. So the one who has a sound mind would reject such a thing. The one who created a human being cannot be a human being. I'm a human being like you. I get sick, you get sick. I get tired, you get tired. I sleep, you sleep. I eat, you eat. So I can't be your creator, because we are similar to each other. And those who are similar to each other are susceptible to what could happen to any of them. And because you are a human being, that means you are going to die. And that's why all the previous human beings, what happened to them? They died. There is no human being that is immortal. They are going to die. So once you say, I'm a human being, the conclusion is, I am going to die. Because, you know, this is why they say, you know, when they teach you at universities about the logic and the two premises and one result, what do they say? For instance, humans die. I am a human, so what's the result now? I will die. So they talk about this, you know, at the university, you hear about it. We are human beings. Human beings, amongst their characteristics, they get tired, they get sick, they die. So anyone who is a human being, all these things will happen to him. That's why Prophet Isa alayhi salam is not God. Prophet Isa alayhi salam is a human being. He was born at a time. So even before that time, he did not exist. And he's a human being. He used to eat and drink. And he used to fast. So he's like us. So he can't be God. You cannot give a human being the attribute of God, because he's a creation of God. So there is a big difference between the creator and the creation. Allah Azza wa Jal does not resemble the creations in any way whatsoever, simply because Allah is their creator. For that reason, Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu said, أَنَّا يُشْبِهُ الْخَالِقُ مَخْلُوقَهُ, meaning it's impossible for the creator to resemble his creations. It's impossible. So if you want to convince someone that a human being can't be God, simply you tell him a human being is like us. He gets tired, I get tired, and the like. You make this argument and you show him that his claim is false. It can't be right. The sun is not God, although some people worship the sun and they call it God. Some people worship the moon and they call it God. Some people worship the planets and they call them gods. To show that this is false, you say, the sun is a creation. The proof that it is a creation is that it has limits and boundaries, size, quantity, mass, shape, volume, etc. And whatever has these specifications must be in need of the one who made it with these specifications. Because why the sun is not bigger, although logically it's possible for the sun to be bigger, why it's not smaller, why it doesn't have different shape, it's not a triangle, because there is one who made it with these specifications. And that is proof that the sun is a creation. Because anything that has limits, that has volume, shape, quantity, mass, why it is specified with all these specifications? Why not having other specifications when logically it can accept other specifications? Is it because it is the sun, so it must be with these specifications? No. Not for just being the sun, that means it has to be with these specifications. Because the sound mind judges that this is something that has a volume, shape, mass, quantity, and the like, and it's possible to have different specifications, and it cannot specify itself with these specifications, so there must be one who specified it with these specifications. And that shows that the sun is a creation and it cannot be the creator. You as a human being, look at yourself. Not because you are a human being, you must have two eyes. They both must be on your face. You know how some animals have eyes here on the side? It's possible to have eyes here on the side. You have your nose here, you have a mouth, you have all these specifications. So not because you are a human being, that means it is intellectually necessary to have all these specifications. No. Rather, the sound mind judges that there is one who willed for you to be in these specifications. And when you look at yourself and others, compare yourself with others, you see you have different shape, different volume, different weight, different quantity, different skin color and the like. You know that there is one who willed for all these human beings to be in the way they are. And that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the sound mind judges that the creator does not resemble the creations. And look at this ayah. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. First, negation of any resemblance of Allah to the creations. That's the first of it. وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ, meaning Allah is attributed with hearing and sight. So the one who has a sound mind would quickly comprehend that the hearing of Allah is not like our hearing. The seeing of Allah is not like our seeing. How do you see? Allah created this eye for you. That pupil inside your eye, you look and you see by it. But you have limit. You can see at a certain distance. You can't see what is behind the wall or what is inside the ground at the bottom. You can't see this. So this instrument, this device that Allah created for you to help you see the objects. Allah created the ear for you so you can hear. And the way you hear also, you can hear at a certain limit. You can't hear what is far away from you. Just to a certain distance, you can hear. So your hearing is limited. So this is a device that Allah created for you to help you hear by it. This is a device that Allah created for you to help you see the objects. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees everything, all the seeable things, without being in need of a pupil or any other instrument. Allah hears all the hearable things without being in need of an ear or any other instrument or device. Because Allah is the creator. Allah does whatever He wills. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, all the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal do not resemble the attributes of the creations. So the life of Allah is not like our life. Our life is composed of what? Body, soul, flesh, bones, veins. But the life of Allah is not like our life. Also, the knowledge of Allah is not like our knowledge. Because our knowledge is limited, our knowledge increases and decreases. Our knowledge is created. When you were born, you did know nothing. You started acquiring the knowledge. Every day you learn something new. So your knowledge has a beginning, it increases and decreases, develops, changes, but the knowledge of Allah is not like our knowledge. Allah knows everything, knows what happened, what's happening, what's going to happen. What is not happening, if it were to happen, how it's going to happen, Allah knows about it. Nothing is hidden from the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the knowledge of Allah is not like our knowledge. Very simple. Very simple. Also, the power of Allah is not like our power. All the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are not like the attributes of the creations. Although sometimes you use the same terms, yeah, but that doesn't mean the same meaning is applied. No. You say Allah is attributed with knowledge, you say Imam Abu Hanifa is attributed with knowledge, but that doesn't mean it is the same. When you say Allah is alive, and you say about yourself, I am alive, Allah is attributed with life, I am attributed with life, that doesn't mean there is resemblance between Allah and the creations. No. This is agreement with the terms, but not the meanings. Not the meanings. So all the attributes of Allah do not resemble the attributes of the creations. Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi radiyallahu anhu is talking about now is al-kalam, speech. Allah Azza wa Jal is attributed with al-kalam. As Allah said in the Quran, وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. And the proof about this attribute is that had Allah not been attributed with kalam, speech, He would be mute. And to be mute is an attribute of imperfection. And Allah is clear of being attributed with any attribute of imperfection. So Allah must be attributed with al-kalam, speech. However, we use the same rule. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. So as we understand from the first section of the ayah that nothing resembles Allah in any way, then we understand from the second part of the ayah that Allah is attributed with hearing and sight, and that means the hearing of Allah is not like our hearing, the seeing of Allah is not like our seeing, same we say, the kalam of Allah is not like our kalam. The speech of Allah is not like our speech. Now, what is our speech composed of? It's composed of language, letters, sounds. It has a beginning, it has an end. This is our kalam. And there are interruptions when we talk, if you're making conversation with someone, you say something, then you listen to him, then you say something, so it's starting, ending. That continuous interruption shows that your kalam is created. Your kalam is created. Because it has a beginning, it has an end. This is very obvious. Even when I talk, you started listening. What I mentioned at the beginning of the lesson, that's it, gone. It's past tense now. So that means it started, it ended. So my speech is created. And that shows that I am created as well. Because the created attribute is an indication that the attributed self is created for a greater reason. I'll repeat. What does it mean? The scholars use this proof. When a human being is born, he doesn't know how to talk. He knows nothing. He doesn't know how to walk. He starts gaining attributes that he didn't have when he was first born. He starts acquiring attributes. So when he starts talking, this is something new, happened in himself. So he gained an attribute. This attribute was not in him when he was born. Now he gained this attribute. So that created attribute occurred in his self. What does that prove? It proves that his self is created. So it's impossible that Allah Azza wa Jal would have a created attribute. Because a created attribute would entail that the self that is attributed with this attribute is created as well. For that reason, Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu and Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi is Hanafi, said in his book Al-Fiqh al-Akbar clearly, وَصِفَاتُهُ غَيْرُ مُحْدَثَةٍ وَلَا مَخْلُوقَ وَمَنْ قَالَ بِحُدُوثِ صِفَاتِ اللَّهِ أَوْ شَكَّ أَوْ تَوَقَّفَ فَهُوَ كَافِرٌ. Very explicit. He said that the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal are not created or originated. And whoever claims that any of Allah's attributes is created or originated, or he doubts about this matter, or he remains undecided about this matter, like to say, I don't say it is created and I don't say it is not. He's undecided in between. He doesn't want to say this or that. Imam Abu Hanifa said he's a blasphemer. So the one who claims that any of the attributes of Allah is created, the one who doubts about this, the one who remains undecided whether to say they are created or not, is a blasphemer. Imam Abu Hanifa made it very explicit. So all the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are not created, because Allah is the creator. Because the created attribute, that's the rule, entails that the attributed self with that created attribute is created as well. It's not hard, it's easy to be comprehended. So Allah Azza wa Jal is the creator, and Allah Azza wa Jal has attributes that Allah deserves to be attributed with, because Allah is the creator. When we say Allah sees all the seeable things, Allah hears all the hearable things, this is because Allah is the creator. And this is a necessary attribute for the creator, because the creator cannot be mute or death and the like. So Allah hears everything, Allah sees everything, but without any resemblance between Allah and the creations. So after this rule is clarified, we go to what Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi mentioned, that Allah is attributed with al-kalam, the speech, and that the speech of Allah is not like our speech. So it's not a language, it's not letters or sounds, it's not like this. And as Allah Azza wa Jalla does not resemble the creations, His attributes do not resemble the attributes of the creations. Now listen carefully. He said the Quran is the kalam, speech of Allah. Allah is the one who revealed its expression to His Prophet without His own attribute of speech resembling any attribute of the creation. The believers believe with certainty that it is the kalam of Allah, the Exalted, and that it is not created like the speech of the creations. So the kalam of Allah is not like our kalam. Our kalam is created. On the day of judgment, while the non-believers are in hellfire and they're getting tortured in hellfire and they're getting burned, on that day, these skins will testify against the non-believers. These skins will testify against them. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, what the non-believers would say, they talk to their skin. Allah Ta'ala said, وَقَالُوا لِجُلُودِهِمْ لِمَ شَهِدْتُمْ عَلَيْنَا قَالُوا أَنْطَقَنَا اللَّهُ الَّذِي أَنْطَقَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ وَقَالُوا لِجُلُودِهِمْ لِمَ شَهِدْتُمْ عَلَيْنَا. They talk to their skin, why do you testify against us? What do they reply? They say, أَنْطَقَنَا اللَّهُ الَّذِي أَنْطَقَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. Allah is the one who created the talking in us. So our talk is created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not resemble the creations in any way, and His speech kalam does not resemble the kalam of the creations. Whoever hears the Quran, Imam Abu Ja'far says, and falsely says that it is composed by a human being, is a blasphemer. Allah dispraised, censured, and threatened such a person with saqar. That's one of the names of hellfire. He, the Exalted, said, sa'uslihi saqar, which means, I will burn him in hellfire. Since Allah threatened with saqar, the one who says, in hadha illa qawlul bashar, meaning the one who says that this book is composed by a human, we know for certain that it is revealed by the creator of mankind and that his speech does not resemble the speech of mankind. Now, to make this case simple to be comprehended, we have to understand that the term Al-Quran is used Islamically for two things. When referring to the attribute of speech of Allah Azza wa Jalla, you can call this Quran. So you can say Allah is attributed with Al-Quran. Al-Qur'an here means the speech of Allah, the kalam of Allah. And Al-Qur'an can be used in reference to the revealed book, which the one that is revealed to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Al-Qur'an, is in what language? Arabic. The Torah that Allah revealed to Prophet Musa alayhi salam was in what language? Hebrew language. And the Evangel, Al-Injil, that was revealed to Prophet Isa, Jesus alayhi salam, was in what language? Syriac language. So the books were revealed in different languages. The books were revealed in different languages. That doesn't mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks Arabic and Hebrew and Syriac. No. Rather, these books are expressions that were revealed to the prophets. They are expressions of the eternal kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not the real kalam of Allah azza wa jal. I'll give you another example. If you write on the board the word fire, F-I-R-E, if you ask someone, what is this? What he's going to say? Fire. Yeah, but does that mean if you touch it, you'll get burnt? Does that mean you can cook on it? You can start barbecuing on it? No. But you call it fire. But what do you mean by it? This is, or this word is an expression that is used when I want to express about what? About the actual fire that burns. So this is an expression. It's not the real fire. It's an expression. Another example. If you write on the board the word Allah, if you ask someone what is this, he's going to say Allah. But that doesn't mean this is what I worship, these letters, Alif, Lam, Lam, Ha, this is what I worship. No. Or in English, A, double L, A, H. It doesn't mean this is what I worship. These letters are expressions of what? Of the Creator that we worship. Indication, expression. So it doesn't mean we worship these letters. Rather, this is an indication or expression of the Creator of the universe. Same with the Quran that we carry now and we read in it. We say, this is Kalamullah. This is Al-Quran Kalamullah. But we don't mean here that these actual words are the attribute of Allah Azza wa Jal. No. Because the attribute of Allah cannot be confined in a creation, in a book. The Creator cannot be confined in the creation. And the attributes of Allah cannot be confined in the creations. Because Allah is the Creator. Allah does not incarnate in the creations. You know what the word incarnate means? To dwell in. To dwell in, to occupy. The Creator does not incarnate in the creations. And the attributes of Allah do not incarnate in the creations as well. So when you say this is Kalamullah, you don't mean that I have the attribute of Allah between my hands. No, you mean this is an expression that was revealed to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's from Allah. When we say it is from Allah, as Imam Abu Ja'far said, meaning it's not authored by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's not compiled or composed by Jibreel alayhi salam. No, it is Kalamullah. When we say it is Kalamullah, it is the expressions that were revealed to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they were not composed by Jibreel alayhi salam. So that's why whoever claims that this Quran is composed by a human or an angel blasphemes. Because if this Quran is composed by Jibreel, then we cannot call it Kalamullah. Then we call it what? Kalamu Jibreel. If it's composed by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we can't call it Kalamullah, we call it Kalamu Muhammad. As you know, we say this is the hadith of the Prophet Because the Prophet said it. This is the hadith of the Prophet. هَذَا كَلَامُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم. But about the Quran, what do we say? This is كَلَامُ اللَّهِ. Not كَلَامُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. Not كَلَامُ جِبْرِيل. كَلَامُ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. Yeah, but yet this does not mean that these expressions in Arabic are the exact attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No. That's not the meaning of it. This is an expression of it. Now the word Al-Qur'an, Kalamullah, Al-Qur'an, Kalamullah, can be used in reference to the book that we read that starts with Al-Fatiha, ends with Surat An-Nas. Can be used in reference to this book. And sometimes it can be used as the book itself, or sometimes the recitation that you make. As Allah Ta'ala said in the Quran, أَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِدُلُوكِ الشَّمْسِ إِلَىٰ غَسَقِ اللَّيْلِ وَقُرْآنَ الْفَجْرِ إِنَّ قُرْآنَ الْفَجْرِ كَانَ مَشْهُودًا وَقُرْآنَ الْفَجْرِ وَقُرْآنَ الْفَجْرِ, meaning the recitation in the dawn prayer. So what did Allah call the recitation in the dawn prayer? Quran. Also the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَا تُسَافِرُوا بِالْقُرْآنِ إِلَىٰ أَرْضِ الْعَدُوِ. Do not travel with the Quran to the lands of the enemies, to the enemies' territories. Why? Because they might degrade it. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, do not travel with the Quran to the enemy's territory. Why? Because they might degrade it. The Prophet said, لَا تُسَافِرُوا بِالْقُرْآنِ إِلَىٰ أَرْضِ الْعَدُوِ. What does he mean by لَا تُسَافِرُوا بِالْقُرْآنِ? Al-Mushaf. So you can see from this hadith, Al-Quran is used in reference to the Mushaf. In the other ayah, وَقُرْآنَ الْفَجْرِ means the recitation of the dawn prayer. Also, Al-Quran can be used when referring to the attribute of kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That can be used for this and for that, for both. And Islamically, yes, it is used for both. It is used for both. When Allah said, وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا, that means Allah is attributed with kalam. Allah Ta'ala said, وَإِنْ أَحَدٌ مِّنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ اسْتَجَارَكَ فَأَجِرْهُ حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ. It doesn't mean until he becomes like Prophet Musa alayhi salam to hear the kalam of Allah. No. To hear what? The Quran. So, Kalamullah in this ayah is in reference to the Quran that we read. So as we can see, the word Kalamullah can be used for the attribute of Allah Azza wa Jal and for the revealed books. Same with Al-Quran, can be used for the attribute of Allah Azza wa Jal, Al-Kalam, and can be used when in reference to the revealed books. It depends on the context, you know. But the scholars said, if you want to use a general term, you say Al-Quran, Kalamullah, you must say, is not created. Why they say this? So no one would misconstrue and think that the attribute of Kalam of Allah is created. So they say, when you are using this statement in general, you say Kalamullah, Al-Quran Kalamullah, then you must say is not created. Because when it is used in general, it will be taken as in reference to the attribute of Allah Azza wa Jal. But if you say Al-Quran Kalamullah, the revealed expression to the Prophet, then you say it's created. It's in Arabic language. It has a beginning, it has an end. It's very obvious that it is created. In the past, this was a major debate between Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah and the Mu'tazila and the Mushabbiha. Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi is mentioning this so the Muslim can be equipped with the correct knowledge about Kalamullah Azza wa Jal. Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah held many debates about this case in particular. The Mu'tazila negated the attribute of Kalam of Allah Azza wa Jal. They said, no, Allah cannot be attributed with Kalam, cannot be attributed with power, cannot be attributed with hearing and sight. So they denied the attributes of Allah and they blasphemed. They took that extreme. The Mushabbiha, Mujassima, those who liken Allah to the creations, said, Allah is attributed with Kalam, but His Kalam is like our Kalam. It's made up of language, sounds, letters, same as we talk. So they liken Allah to the creations. Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the majority of this nation, remained in the middle. What did they say? They said, Allah is attributed with Al-Kalam, but Kalam of Allah is not like our Kalam. Very simple. As Allah is attributed with hearing, and the hearing of Allah is not like our hearing. As Allah is attributed with sight, and the sight of Allah is not like our sight. Same with the case of Al-Kalam. Clear? Easy? Those whose heart is open can comprehend it easily. Allah does not resemble the creations, full stop. If Allah's Kalam is made up of language, letters and sounds, Allah wouldn't have said in the Quran, ثُمَّ رُدُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ مَوْلَاهُمُ الْحَقُّ أَلَا لَهُ الْحُكْمُ وَهُوَ أَسْرَعُ الْحَاسِبِينَ وَهُوَ أَسْرَعُ الْحَاسِبِينَ Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala finishes the judgment of all human beings and jinn in the quickest way. In a moment, on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enables every single human being and jinn to hear the kalam of Allah azza wa jal that is not made up of language, letters and sounds. Everyone will understand from it the question about what he has said, what he has believed and what he has done in one moment on the day of judgment. If the kalam of Allah is like our kalam, like you, how you judge your son or daughter, for instance, how you question them, why you did so and so, for instance, then the judgment will take thousands of years. Thousands of years. Because the jinn live for thousands of years. And some humans in the past lived for thousands of years. Zulqarnain is mentioned in the Quran. Zulqarnain is mentioned in Surah Al-Kahf, the one who trapped Ya'juj and Ma'juj, Gog and Magog. He's the one who trapped them and he built a high wall against the mountains and he trapped them in that place so they can't get out of that place. They trapped. One day they will manage to come out of it, but they are trapped. Zulqarnain, his name is As-Sa'b. That was his name. One of the poets said, الصعب ذو القرنين أمسى ملكه ألفين عاما ثم صار رميما. He lived for how many years? 2000. Prophet Nuh عليه السلام lived as some scholars said, for about 1,750. So they used to live for that amount of years. So, and Iblis, since Allah created him, he didn't die. He will die on the day of judgment when angel Israfil alayhi salam blows in the horn. He will die at that time. How many thousands of years will it be? Thousands of years. How many evil did Satan, Iblis, commit since day one? So if he were to be questioned, as we question each other, why you did so and so on such and such a day? Why you did so and so on such and such a day? For how long it will take just to finish the judgment of Iblis himself? Thousands of years. Gog and Magog, Ya'juj and Ma'juj, it was narrated in the hadith that all the human beings, in reference or in comparison to Ya'juj and Ma'juj in number, I'm talking about the number, is like 1%. In another narration, 1 per 1,000. 1 per 1,000. So they are more than the human beings by multiple numbers. And they are all blasphemers, Ya'juj and Ma'juj. By the way, it's not authenticated that they are midgets and they have two big E's, they sleep on one and they cover themselves with the other one. This is not true, this is a fabrication. They are human beings, but they are all blasphemers. They're still alive from that time. And the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that before any of them dies, he sees 1,000 of his offspring. So that's why, although they're dying one after another since they were trapped, but before one dies, he will see 1,000 of his offspring. So you can't imagine when he dies, so he's replaced by 1,000, in other words. How many are they now? And they haven't discovered where they are despite all the satellites they have. They couldn't find them yet. So going back to our topic, what do we learn from this? We learn that the kalam of Allah is not like our kalam. Because had it been with letters and sounds, Allah wouldn't have mentioned about himself that he is Asra'ul Hasibin, the quickest in judging people. The quickest in judging people because the kalam of Allah is not like our kalam. If it's like our kalam, wouldn't be the quickest. It will take thousands of years to judge human beings and jinn. This is proof from the Quran that the kalam of Allah cannot be like our kalam. Cannot be like our kalam. Then Imam Abu Ja'far continues to say, the one who attributes to Allah a characteristic of mankind is a blasphemer. Very clear. What are amongst our characteristics? Sitting, eating, drinking, going up, down, moving, settling, having a body, a shape, a volume, moving from one place to another, being in a direction, all these are amongst our attributes, amongst our characteristics. So Imam Abu Ja'far said, the one who attributes to Allah a characteristic of mankind is a blasphemer. Hence, he who looks thoroughly into this takes warning, refrains from the sayings of the blasphemers, and knows that Allah, having his attributes, does not resemble mankind. Nice words. The way he said them. I'll repeat it. Hence, he who looks thoroughly into this takes warning, refrains from sayings of the blasphemers, and knows that Allah, having his attributes, does not resemble mankind. As Allah said in the Quran, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. From this ayah, the scholars deduce that Allah does not resemble any of the creations in any way whatsoever. It's very obvious, very clear. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. And it's the most explicit ayah in the Quran, most explicit ayah of the Quran, that negates any resemblance of Allah to the creations. There are other ayahs like هَلْ تَعْلَمُ لَهُ سَمِيًّا فَلَا تَضْرِبُوا لِلَّهِ الْأَمْثَالِ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ. All these ayahs negate any resemblance of Allah to the creations. But this ayah is the most explicit one. Then Imam Abu Ja'far, may Allah raise his rank, said, the seeing of Allah by the people of paradise without circumscription or resemblance to the creations is true, as pronounced in the book of our Lord, وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاظِرَةٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ. The saying mentioned in the ayah is in accordance with Allah's will and knowledge. All of what is narrated about this in the Sahih Hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is as he said and with the meaning he intended. We do not indulge in this matter, assigning wrong meanings to it with our own opinions or misconceiving it with our delusions, because no one's religion is safe except if one submits oneself to Allah the Exalted and to His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam and ascribes the knowledge of what is ambiguous to him to the one who knows it. Okay, now he's talking about one of the beliefs of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. Also in this case, you're gonna see, we have one extreme, another extreme, then Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah in the middle. About seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's true. It's gonna happen for the people of paradise. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَمَا إِنَّكُمْ سَتَرَوْنَ رَبَّكُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. You will definitely see your Lord on the day of judgment. When the believers are in paradise, Allah enables them to see Allah without Allah being in a place or direction, and without Allah having a shape or a volume, and without a distance between Allah and the creations. It's not like the way you see a creation. Now look, we are creations. Now the way you are looking at me, everyone is looking at a direction because I am in a place. So you look this way and that way and that way. And also there is a distance between me and each one of you. One is closer, one is farther, and so on. This is the way we see a creation. But Allah Azza wa Jalla, the one who exists without a place, the one who does not resemble the creations, is not like us. Now let's see the hadith. إِنَّكُمْ سَتَرَوْنَ رَبَّكُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ كَمَا تَرَوْنَ الْقَمَرَ لَيْلَةَ الْبَدْرِ لَا تَضَامُّونَ فِي رُؤْيَتِهِ. That's according to one narration. In another narration, لَا تُضَامُونَ. Now what does that mean? When the moon was full, he told them, you don't have any doubt that what you see is the moon. No doubt will come to your heart that this is the moon. When you see the moon, when it is full outside, you look at it, do you have any doubt? You won't say, is this the moon or this is a spotlight coming from the building next to us? No. You would say, this is definitely the moon, you have no doubt. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam meant by this that you will have no doubt on the day of judgment. When you see Allah, you will have no doubt. You will be definite that what you saw is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No doubt. But not the way, in the way a creation is seen. لا تضامون. You do not crowd to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You do not do this. Now, just imagine when someone, let us say in a car accident, a driver hits someone, he's on the floor, and everyone wants to come and see him. What will happen? A crowd. It will be crowded. And some will look that way, that way. They want to see, they can't see. So some will not have a what? A proper vision. Because it's crowded. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying that every one of you will see Allah Azza wa Jal in paradise, when they are in paradise, every one of you will be able to see Allah Azza wa Jal, and none of you will be wronged in seeing Allah, meaning no one will have a partial vision, as they say. Everyone will have the full vision. No one will be deprived from the proper vision. And that means Allah exists without a place. Because if Allah is in a place and all the millions want to look at that place, they're going to be crowded and some will not have a proper vision. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying that no one will be deprived from that proper vision. And that means they will see Allah Azza wa Jal without Allah being in a place or direction. This is not something new. This is mentioned in the books of the scholars. Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu in his book Al-Fiqh Al-Akbar said, وَاللَّهُ تَعَالَى يُرَى فِي الْآخِرَةِ يَرَاهُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَهُمْ فِي الْجَنَّةِ بِأَعْيُنِ رُؤُوسِهِمْ بلا كيفية ولا كمية ولا يكون بينه وبين خلقه مسافة. Imam Abu Hanifa mentioned this. Which means the people of paradise will see Allah without Allah being in a place or direction and without resembling the creations and without a distance between Allah and the believers in paradise. Because Allah exists without a place. Because Allah is not a body. Now some people, I'll conclude by this, some people would say, they want to think about it, and they might say, I cannot comprehend it in my mind. Yeah, because you are applying the rules that you apply to a creation to Allah Azza wa Jal. But here you're not talking about a human being, you're talking about the creator that does not resemble the creation. You got used to see what? To see objects in places, directions. But Allah is not like this. Allah is the creator of places and directions. So Allah does not resemble any of the creations. And you say, We cannot encompass Allah in our minds because we are creations. We are creation. We believe in what Allah mentioned in the Quran, and we clear Allah of any non-befitting attribute, and we attribute to Allah all the attributes of perfection that befit Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we do not indulge in this manner, engage further to imagine God, because no one would be able to. For that reason, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, do not attempt to imagine God. Because you're going to end up imagining what? Having an image about the creation, something big, tall, wide, with hands, organs. That's what you're going to imagine. And this is not God. This is an image that you imagine. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase our knowledge and to keep us steadfast on the belief of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah and make our end as righteous Muslims. Ameen. And Allah knows best. We say La ilaha illallah 3 times.